want to welcome you all to our next installment of the Army Leader Exchange. This is our 20th in the series and our third in a book series. So today's featured book is going to be When the Pressure's On. It's listed back here. And I'm really pleased to introduce our guest speaker today, somebody that I've known specifically or directly for the last 5 years. I've been involved with him in something called the Learning Forum. And it's an opportunity to share ideas, and he's going to talk a little bit about that later throughout his presentation, as well as through, I was able to participate in something with the Center for Enhanced Performance, and then which followed on with APEX, and learning some of the techniques that are in the book, and then Brian's going to talk about those today. But I've been I've been allowed to use that throughout my career, and it's really helped in improving the organization. So I'm a personal believer of this stuff, of these ideas, these thoughts, and so I encourage you to, as we're going through, to listen to what Brian has to say, engage him. We're looking for feedback from all over. Brian's going to, as he's going through the experience, talk to you and engage you and ask you questions, so be prepared. Now, a little bit about Brian. He's engaged through the author of the book, through driving, they were partners together in APEX. And unfortunately, what we'd like to do is we'd like to have the author here, but due to health reasons, he can't be here. But actually, what's unique about this is Brian is the one that drove the book. Brian's the guy that drove him to start this process and go through it. So Brian's well-versed in many of the aspects in the book, and we'll talk to you about that. It's just been a real pleasure getting to know him and be a part of these different programs. So with that, I'll turn the floor over to Brian Hackett, our guest speaker.
Thank you, Chris. Is this mic on? Can you hear me? Good. Well, like you said, Lewis couldn't be here because actually Lewis had a stroke almost 2 years ago. And once he sees this presentation and what I do to his book, he'd be inspired to get back on his feet. He is back on his feet, but he's still working at being up to travel and do things like this. But he's actually using some of the work that he learned about neuroplasticity to actually heal himself from a stroke. So it's going to be a great story. I'm honored to be here. My connection to the Army goes back to my father was a master sergeant, drill instructor. We had 9 kids, so he did a good job teaching us how to stay in line. His brother was in the Bataan Death March, survived that. And his other brother was a scout for Patton. And then on my mother's side, all 5 of her brothers were in the service during World War II. And then in my family, my oldest brother, unfortunately went into the Navy. My next brother went into the Army during Vietnam. And then my younger brother went into the Air Force. That left me Coast Guard or Marines. But at that point in history, there was nothing in the military to do, so I went to college. So let me start with a little bit about the Learning Forum is what I do on my regular job. That's my business. And it's actually 15 groups of executives from large companies that get together, and these are the groups. These are the topics they cover. And they meet 3 times a year to talk about these issues. So we really get current, candid information on all of these topics. And, you know, the passion for me has always been around leader development, talent management, knowledge management. And those top things are all the ones that I run personally. The other ones I kind of outsource to former members who are now my partners. I actually do the innovation and foresight groups as well. But so what? This is a list of some of the companies in the group. I highlighted the non-business members, which includes the Army and the Marines. There's 2 other 3-letter agencies that aren't listed. And I guess the only other thing is I don't work for the Russians. I want to give you a background on Lewis, because this whole story is really about Lewis and his work. So Lewis, he came over from Hungary in 1950. In 1959, he graduated high school, and he wanted to go to West Point. And his guidance counselor told him he was nuts. You're not going to get into West Point. So he went, and he didn't know how to do the process to get into West Point. So he went to the Valley Forge Military Academy. Can anybody tell me what other Army general went to Valley Forge Military Academy? You get a free book if You can guess. H.R. McMaster went to Valley Forge. So anyway, what Lewis did, he knew he wanted to go to West Point, so he spent those 2 years at Valley Forge just setting that goal to get to West Point, and he did. And then the first year he was at West Point, he was number one in his class. So next after that is 1965. He graduates, he goes to Germany, but by 1968, he's in Vietnam. There's a picture of Lewis with Jimmy Stewart somewhere in Vietnam. And Lewis is, he worked in what they call the Riverine Force, and so he also went to Army Ranger School, so that was all part of his background in, you know, what he did as a, up till then as a captain. During, in 1968, he got the Silver Star for this, and I want to let you read this because it's part of his story. So this engagement and quite a few others was what propelled him to want to teach leadership at that level. And you know what's interesting about Lewis is he kind of mentioned some of that in the book, maybe a sentence here or there, but he'd probably kill me for putting that up there. He would never want guys like you to think about him from that level. He wants the work he did to be what you pay attention to. But I think it's important to understand that, you know, when he went from that to 1989, when he was up teaching at West Point, he's teaching leadership to a bunch of kids who's like, how do I get them to understand this level of leadership when it really matters? And so what happened in 1989, he read this, he was playing tennis up at West Point with his, you know, Hagenbach was one of his tennis buddies. And the more he got into competitive tennis, the worse he started to play. And he's a psychologist. And he's like, what's going on here? I'm a good tennis player. So he knew it was all mental. And have anybody ever heard of this book, The Inner Game of Tennis? Of course you have, Megan. Megan's really the expert in the room on all this peak performance stuff. So when the tough questions come, Megan's going to get to answer them. I found Megan yesterday online. And she happened to be here in Kansas City. She works for the Comprehensive Soldier Fitness doing their curriculum. And she was actually hired by Lewis, right? Yep. Just like I was. Actually, the reason I got to know Lewis was I went to work for the conference board, and he hired me to do training, I mean, to do research on leadership development. And the only problem was I didn't have a PhD, so he really wasn't going to hire me. But I convinced him I'd go get one. I never did, but that's another story for another day. So anyway, this inner game of tennis, the whole concept was this notion of performance equals potential minus interference, and the interference was coming from inside your head. And so this guy, Tim Galway, created a great process to teach athletes. He would be able to teach an amateur to play tennis or to play fairly good tennis without in one day, without just doing mental coaching, without any technique. And that kind of started the whole sports psychology business and industry. So when Lewis saw this, this is how it clicked for him that he could connect this to leadership development. And so he went and studied what peak performance was going on in mostly the sports field. He went to East Germany at the time and Russia because they had the more advanced work with their Olympic teams. And then he had them come to West Point and further, you know, learn what was going on. So he took all these concepts around sports psychology and he reverse engineered it into his model, which is in the book, which in essentially took out all the crap. You know, there's a lot of crap in this psychology space. He took it out so he could find something you could use to train, in this case, cadets at West Point. So he designed this integrated training approach, which I'll share with you in a minute. And then the other thing about Lewis and his work, he's continued to focus on the neuroscience aspect of this training, which is the real cutting edge stuff, which I'll get to at the end of this presentation. So this was from 1989. He basically had to convince the soup at the time to set up this type of training, and He got Dave Palmer to sign in, so Lewis gives most of his credit to General Palmer for making the decision to go ahead with this crazy idea. And then this, I came across this article, which I also want to give you time to read. And the point here is that in 1989, Lewis knew that this would become Army training, right? He didn't design this just for cadets to learn how to be better students or better athletes. He understood it was for leader development. I'm not advancing. Chris, well, you got it? So, here's a quote. Whoop, can we go back? Go forward. You got it? Go forward one? No. Let's go back. We should go forward, please. One more. There should have been one before this. All right, right there. So, for a book, we know that's General Schwarzkopf in the chair, in the famous egg chair. Anybody recognize anybody else in that picture? Chris? Up there in the top, in the captain's uniform. Not to you.
Colin Powell?
Nope, good guess. Someday. It's Bob Brown. Bob Brown was, nobody gets the book. I can't give this book away. Bob Brown was the first green suiter that Lewis could hire in his center. This was his captain, Bob Brown. And it's probably why General Brown is so interested in some of this work today. The other people in the picture was Coach Jim Young, who he bought into this training right away. And I happen to know a lot of the players from that era, from 1991, 92. And most of them still talk about how they use that training today. It's just become part of who they are. And then one of the big successes he had was Mike Mayweather, who was probably 5'6", but he ended up being a Heisman Trophy nominee, and he broke all the records at the time. But he also was struggling just to get through West Point. So he was using both the training to help him on the football field, but also just to get through the West Point. So that's part of Mike's story. So there's our General Brown today, and some of the two quotes up front are basically from the foreword in the book, and the other quote is just something I've heard him say over and over, which is the essence of this work on peak performance. So now I'm going to give you a quick history of some of the peak performance research that had gone on in the Army. So 1993, when Bob was a major, he did this article with Lewis. Notice the nice funky typeface from the 90s. Then in 2004, General Schumacher visited the center at West Point, and his first reaction was, we need to have this training in other parts of the Army, not just up at West Point. So that's actually when I tracked down Lewis, who was retired at the time, and said, you know, the Army's going to design this training. You're the guy that's going to have to do it for them. And so we started APEX. And so it was basically so Lewis could advise the Army on how to do this. And so then at about the same time, this is General Webster, who was probably one of the main guys behind the human dimension concept back in that time. So what we did when we started APEX, we started the Army Center for Enhanced Performance. And that's what it was called before it ended up being morphed into Comprehensive Soldier Fitness. But the logical place to start something on peak performance was with the Green Berets and the Army Rangers, because one, Lewis was living in North Carolina, and two, why not start with a, you know, a more elite unit to teach a more elite type of leadership. So that's how we started. And this was some of the original collateral from back in the day. I don't know if they're still using this. I know that logo's probably changed. Actually, it probably has because it's not ASEP anymore. But these are the concepts of Lewis's model to teach how to be better at mental training. So this is just a screenshot from the West Point CEP at the time. And this is also a screenshot from when it was ASEP and some of the similar quotes from the similar generals. This was their concept at the time, which I'm going to show you the APEX model, which is a little simpler than the Army model. The Army seems to always complicate things. So they ended ASAP after Fort Bragg. The next one they set up was at Fort Jackson, and then it just moved around the country and actually to other bases around the world. But like I said, that all got converted into comprehensive soldier fitness for other reasons. But then again, this is the original model to work at essentially goal setting isn't really the best term. We like to call it goal attainment, but I'll explain that in a minute. But it's really about how you have to do a certain kind of goal setting to end up having really change your behaviors to have a peak performance mindset. And a big part of that is how you handle your physiology, but also how you handle your mental attention and how it's all related. And I'll get into as much of that as I can explain, and Megan might have to help me explain the real science because she's actually trained in this space. So for further history into this, you know, so then 2008, General Palmer puts out his first human dimension paper and gets into this idea of cognitive performance. But what's kind of interesting was he didn't know. So now it's 2008, the CEPs are already up and running since 89, ASEP is up and running since 2004, and it seemed like Palmer had no clue that that stuff was going on. So it's kind of an interesting thing. The Army's a big place, but if you're talking cognitive, shouldn't all the people dealing with something cognitive know each other? And it's surprising that that's the case that they don't. So this is one of the key concepts that came out of his paper. And you know, General Palmer's retired now, but he's still out there trying to push the human dimension concepts from his perspective. He's actually got this notion of doing brain training 101, which is pretty interesting. Then I came across this other paper that, again, the interesting part was these guys, these lieutenant colonels and this Gerald Graham was a sports psychologist, PhD, but they hadn't referenced any of the other former work. So I actually got to talk to Sandy Graham the other day, which was pretty enlightening because I actually learned some new things just from talking to him. And the whole point is if we can get all these people talking together, you got a better product, and we got to figure out, I think the Army's got to figure out a way to do that. So this is just another article from the same time. And then another one that came across was this Captain Dibble, who did another pretty good article on the connection between the West Point CEP and the evolution to CSF. And then just yesterday, I got an email from Gary Klein. Gary's a captain. He might be a major now. But in 2015, he also wrote an article, which I forgot I even read. So last night, I threw this slide in. Because Gary's actually here taking a course this morning. But he did a great little paper where he looked at all the other cognitive training going on at the Army. And he looked at asymmetric warfare group. He looked at CSF. He looked at some other things that I didn't even haven't heard of and had kind of the same point. There's a lot of this cognitive training going on. Why aren't we all talking to each other? And then you got the human dimension concept, which the interesting, from my perspective, is they're not realizing they could go back to more of the core cognitive skills training than all the other things they're thrown into human dimension at this point. So ironically, all that said, even Lewis, when he was doing his work, didn't know about this work that was done in 1986. So he was a victim of the same process. So it's just kind of interesting to me that a lot of this work has been going on for a long time, and how do we get it to be more part of the bigger system? So now let's kind of get into what Lewis's work is all about. It's the interesting part is it seems to be to get to this level of real peak performance training like Lewis has designed it, it seems to be a bit of a challenge to get it into a large organization. And I think one of the lessons I learned was don't try to get it into the whole organization. Get it into the places where you have people who already have the passion to be elite at whatever they want to do, because then they'll put in the homework to get that level of training done, just like a pro athlete. And Lewis has worked with a lot of pro athletes and actually with a lot of corporate executives. And that's what he almost starts right off with, understanding, do they have the inner desire to do this kind of work? If not, why waste each other's time? So think about this for yourselves. Can you think about some time where you had your best performance? Anybody want to volunteer? How about just in an athletic mode? Make it easy. Cummins, sure. You've been in the zone?
I have. I feel like I have.
What'd it feel like?
Things slow down. You're able to do stuff that probably didn't think was as easy as it appeared to be to have happen on the field. So in reference to football, yeah, I've certainly outperformed what I thought I was capable of doing at times.
So yeah, and the thing was, it was so easy and time slowed down. Have anybody you ever had the experience of your life flashing before you? Seriously, you've heard the concept, right? I've had that experience, actually twice. Once I fell off a three-story ladder, and literally time slows down and you see things go through your head that you can't. And there's actually articles on this now, research that shows why that happens. It's kind of amazing, but it happened to me twice. And the second time I went, does anybody know where Loveland Pass in Colorado is? It's on the Continental Divide. Well, I was in a whiteout on a Friday afternoon and went right off the cliff. And literally, that maybe 15 seconds of flying down into the snow, I had that feeling. So anyway, the whole point is this happens. This notion of being in the zone, being in the flow, happens. And so that's one of the things Lewis was looking at, is if athletes can do this, a lot of companies can go out and claim they can teach you to get in the zone. Well, they can't. Getting in the zone is just something that happens. But you can learn the skills underlying that can help you get in the zone more often or more quickly. And that was his whole point thinking about it for leadership was, leadership's essentially the point where you have to make decisions. You have to make them clear, quick, the right ones. And he was looking at mostly from the aspect of making decisions under fire. So these are all the types of things that peak performance training can deliver. Probably the key to begin with is just this whole notion of self-awareness, especially for younger people, you get more self-aware, hopefully, as you get older. But if you can learn some of this stuff and how to do it yourself as a younger officer, frankly, you're going to do better with everything else you're doing in life. I think the other interesting thing I was thinking about with this is, so leadership is all these things, right? It's inspiring other people and everything else. But the other interesting part about leadership in large organizations is the ability to deal with bullshit. I was talking to you this morning about that. It's all, we had one of these elite units come look at our training and set up a training center. And, we were talking to them about what is your pressure? Where do you feel the most pressure as why do you need this training? And it wasn't for what they do when they deployed, because they were trained for that, and they're in those jobs because they love to do that kind of work. They said the part where they feel the most stress and where they're not performing well was because of politics in the organization, bureaucracy, you know, dealing with Congress, all those things that they end up having to do in their new jobs, and that's why they would use it. So they were using this more like a corporate executive would have to use it to handle those types of things inside the organization. So this is the model that Lewis came up with when I said, you know, he looked at everything in sports psychology and reverse engineered it. And again, Megan, if I miss anything, chime in, because this is the model you were trained on. But it basically, so there's four skills. The four things on the bottom are skills. The goal setting is a process, but the goal setting process is unique in the way that Lewis designed it. And his whole point was you can't change a behavior or get to any other type of development unless you have a mission and a goal, because otherwise you're not driving to anything specific. And he uses the concepts of imagery and adaptive thinking as part of the goal setting process. So for example, when he works with somebody to design, say I'm going to work with you to design your goals, he actually gets you to write down positive affirmations. Now that sounds like California hot tub stuff, right? Not only does he get you to put these affirmations together in a certain way with certain language, he creates an audio track so you can put it on your phone and you actually listen to that, because that's how your brain works. And so, you know, when I first started working with Lewis and he was showing me this stuff, I'm saying that sounds like, you know, what were those movies? Happy Gilmore, you know, Find Your Happy Place. And what was the other movie with Caddyshack, where, you know, they would say, beat Danny, be the ball, all these kind of California hot tubby psychology notions. But he always backed it up with the fact that these things work. And, you know, they work because this is how the brain works. So his goal setting process included that trick to use this audio track, because that plays in the background and it actually reinforces your positive thinking. And the positive thinking is a very simple, adaptive thinking is what he calls it, but it's really positive thinking. And that's just the fact that we all talk to ourselves all the time. We're going to talk to ourselves till we die. We have 50,000 thoughts a day, and 80% of them are negative. Now, if you can start talking to yourself in a positive way, you're going to have positive goals. If you keep talking to yourself negatively, you're not going to do well. If you tell yourself you're bad at math, you're never going to be good at math. It's simple as that. So, you know, he's worked so long with soldiers that he's come up with a long list of things that he can help soldiers right away, you know, put in their kit and train to, and he didn't have to redesign that. Then the next aspect of this training is the physiology behind tough situations, and that's the fact that, you know, I'll probably skip some slides later because I'm going to cover this now, but Lewis, the way he described it is you have three brains. You have your brain, you have your heart, and you have your gut. Your intrinsic nervous system, your gut, actually informs some of your decisions. You know, you talk about intuition or gut reaction, there's a reason. And then when you talk about in my heart I know, and my heart tells me so, there's a reason we have those phrases too, because what happens is your heart and brain are so connected that you physiologically, under pressure, what happens? Your heart races, you sweat, your hands get clammy, all those things happen every time you're in a tough situation. It could be, you know, for corporate execs, it's mostly when they're doing their performance reviews and things like that, when they're dealing with their staff on things. It's just as stressful as, you know, any other performance domain. So anyway, what we do is we teach people how to control that, and the way we teach it is using biofeedback. So you actually are connected to something where you can see your heart rate. In this case, I'm not going to get too technical, but what's called heart rate variability. So that stuff's in the book, and there's tons of good videos on it, so I'm not going to get into the science of it. But the fact is, it teaches you how to calm down when you need to. And the more you train with this software, it becomes automatic. So there's a NFL kicker that Lewis worked with where he was bouncing around the league. His name's Billy Cundiff. If you're from Baltimore, you know him well, for other reasons. But Billy was bouncing around the league. He was probably on six different teams. And a coach that used to coach at West Point said, you know, Billy, you should go talk to Lewis. So they started working together. And the next year, Billy was 26 for 29 on his field goals. Part of his problem why he wasn't getting picked up on teams, he couldn't kick long field goals. But now after working with Lewis, he tied the record for kicking touchbacks, which if you don't play football, that's kicking it the length of the field. So he ties a record, makes the Pro Bowl. So all these things, he transformed his performance by working with Lewis on his positive thinking, his physiological control, and his pre-shot routine. And the pre-shot routine has a lot to do with this attention control, because that gets back to the idea that we don't really learn how to pay attention. We learn what to pay attention to, but we don't really think about how attention works. And so once you learn, and again, Lewis used EEG feedback, so literally hook you up to sensors so that when he's training you, he can see what's going on in your brain. And again, I'm not going to get into too much of it. I can get to some of it near the end if we have time, but the point is he used real feedback to help coach yourself, because you could feel what it was like to be in that state, that, you know, it's almost like being in the zone. And the last aspect, which probably is the most important, is the power of imagery, which, I mean, a lot of you folks know, you know, you do mental recon, you do things where you kind of go through scenarios in your head, and for athletes, it's huge. I mean, there's so many studies to prove how athletes have, if they do this imagery work in conjunction with their regular training, they always outperform the people that just do more and more training. One of the things that Billy Cundiff did was the other part of his issue with, you know, not being able to kick long kicks was he's kicking all the time in practice, so his leg could never really heal. And so Lewis got him to get to his coach and say, convince your coach that you're going to kick half the number of kicks in practice, so you get time to heal, but you're going to kick 10 times as many kicks in your head. And the other part about kicking in your head and doing imagery well, Billy could go to different fields and different conditions. He could take kicks from different parts of the field in his mind that when he was on the field, it's like, I've been here before. And so the other aspect of this is going to be interesting is with virtual reality and augmented reality and artificial intelligence, that ability to help visualize is going to get even more useful for especially military training. So that's the basic model. This is kind of how it works quickly. So again, goal setting is all about, if you don't know where you're going, you're never going to get there. You have to have this adaptive and positive thinking mindset. Thriving under pressure gets back to that physiological response. Being able to concentrate amongst distractions is being able to understand how you pay attention to how you pay attention. And there's other, it gets a lot more detailed in understanding things like you can only pay attention to one thing at one time. That's physiological. You can't multitask. And you can prove, you know, Lewis will go through a number of examples to show you why you can't multitask. And once you understand that, it informs how you do things, because you realize I can't be trying to do both of these things because I'm not going to do either one well. And then the last is this imagery stuff, is what you see is what you get. And the better you can image things ahead of time, the better you're going to perform. So we talked about paying attention to how you pay attention, visualizing. The other obvious point is, you know, you shouldn't do this unless you really have a clear purpose and the ability to attain those goals. Another way Lewis writes about this, and again, I'm not going to try to replicate everything in the book, but he uses these examples as capacities. And so the skills you learn give you these capacities to do these types of things. And, you know, situational awareness, again, is understanding when and where to attend to what things. Mental agility, this is an example of a pilot who improvised this landing on the rooftop and was able to get his helicopter right on the edge, and he'd never done that before, but he'd thought about it, and so he was able to, in the moment, be able to do it. The learned instinct part was with Sully Sullivan. you know, he had no time to, he had to make that decision like that. So what did he do? He went with his intuition. The reason he was able to do that, he was a glider pilot. So it wasn't hard for him to figure out how to fly a plane without engines. He's done that, but he never did it with this type of plane. And so the other thing was, Sullivan talks about how he locked in, he only had seconds to make this happen. And he talked about he never looked over to his co-pilot because he knew at that point his focus had to be on landing in the Hudson River. So he knew he didn't have time for that. He was so aware, and he trusted his training, he trusted his co-pilot's training, and he went on instinct and had this miraculous event. And then Commander's Com, one of the stories about Eisenhower, well, one was how he did have the demeanor to handle the politics and everything else of D-Day. One of the things that happened as soon as he made the decision, he went and read a book. He went and read a Western novel because he realized at that point there was nothing he could do at that moment. So, you know, it's just an example of how you can shift how you think, and even in a scenario like D-Day. Can we go back and play this video? This is Billy Cardiff talking about some of the what he got out of the training. So might as well have you hear what he had to say.
My journey through the NFL has been pretty interesting. I started out in Dallas, and from there, after four seasons, I moved on to Tampa, where I was an insurance policy for their kicker. They eventually re-signed, which meant that we asked to be released, and the next day I got signed by Green Bay. Went to Green Bay for the off season. Got cut after the first preseason game of training camp. So I think it's about eight different places I've played. Four teams I've played for in the regular season. It's been a long road. So my 2010 season was my best season that I've had to date. It was a lot of fun. I knew I could achieve a high level. I didn't think that my peers and the rest of the media and the NFL world would take notice of it so quick. The greatest achievement of 2010 was making the Pro Bowl. I know that it's the highest honor you can get as the highest individual honor you can get in the NFL. And for me to go from a guy who had to compete for my job to start the season to being voted by my peers as being the top kicker in the AFC was pretty nice. I initially got hooked up with Dr. Choka back in 2007. John Bonamigo was special teams coach for the New Orleans Saints, and I had my exit interview with him when the season was done. I was looking for some feedback from him, and I was thinking that he was going to give me maybe I should work on technique stuff, maybe I need to get stronger. I didn't know quite what to think of what his response was going to be. And he had thought that maybe my issues, or I wouldn't really say issues, maybe the areas I could improve upon were going to be maybe the mental side of the game. And he had had a relationship with Dr. Choka dating back to his time when he was coaching at West Point. So he had said, look, I know of a sports psychologist that's now doing private practice. He had started the sports psychology department, the Center for Enhanced Performance at West Point. You know, he did a lot of great things with our football team. Maybe he'd be able to help you out. So I went ahead and I got a hold of him, and then we started working together once I was with the Atlanta Falcons, and we've been working together ever since. There's a few areas that have made a big difference in especially my kicking. First and foremost would probably have to be the goal setting. Like, I'm a very goal-driven athlete, and for me to set goals, and then not only to set goals, but to have it be part of what I listen to on a daily basis, I think, and then creating the sort of affirmation CD that I use to essentially train my mind to think the way that I want to think. Instead of thinking myself in a much greater capacity, I started to bring my thought patterns bring me down. So I had to find a way to strike this balance. I started to try to create an environment where I was confident, but not arrogant. And I think that Dr. Choka really helped me kind of straddle that line. The other things, the stress management that we use, the techniques that he's taught me, that when I actually can get legitimate feedback from, a lot of other sports psychologists will tell you to breathe, and you're like, that's great. Now, what are you talking about? Like, teach me what you're talking about. Well, through some of the tools that he's used with me, I'm able to get instant feedback. So it's actually a skill that you can acquire. My success last year in touchbacks definitely had a a big factor in that was my mental preparation. A lot of it having to do with just staying relaxed. As I went through the season, I started to kick off pretty well. And then what I started, instead of doing what most athletes do when you do something well, you start realizing, well, I can't believe I'm doing this as well as I'm doing it, and you start to overthink. So what I used is, you know, a lot of the stress management techniques to, when I got into a game, I would get, just said, okay, now it's time to, let's just go kill it. The mental training techniques helped me to stay out of my
own. So that was just from Billy's own words. So we don't have much more time, so I'm going to be quick with this. I think I talked about the three brains, the heart coherence, the other big aspect of this is, if you don't know about neuroplasticity, it's worth Googling it and learning what it means, because that's the essence of this, is you can do things with your mind that physiologically change your brain. And that's the meat of this work, is that neuroplasticity concept. And the technology to do that is getting better and better and easier to train with. So, one of the big phrases they use in neuroscience is that the neurons that fire together wire together, and that's this whole fact that you can rewire your brain. I won't get into this just because we don't have time, but this is basically how the technology works. You're hooked up to some sensors that look at certain brain waves, and then you can know where you're at, and you can learn techniques to get into those states. And there's actually software now that you actually can do some of this just by watching a video and playing games, but you're actually still training your brain to do those things. The software is doing it for you. I won't get into this. If we have questions, we can get deeper into that. So the whole point about imagery too is, when you imagine stuff well in your brain, you're doing imagery the right way. Your brain doesn't know it wasn't real. So like I said, when Billy would go to different parts of the field and kick from different parts of the field, when he got there, he'd been there before. It's like when people learn to do free throws. If they close their eyes and do thousands of perfect free throws in their head, when they go out to perform, their chances of doing the free throws are much, much better. If you guys watch golf, watch Jason Day, and you'll see him do this every shot. He has a very disciplined pre-shot routine where he literally closes his eyes, imagines the shot. Some of that's in the book. But Lewis actually has another book just on golf. So if you guys are golfers, it's worth picking up, because it actually goes through that pre-shot routine and why it works. But the whole point is, when you're an elite athlete like that, you do start to overthink. And when you're performing, at the moment of performance, you don't want to be thinking. And that's the essence of this training, too. So this is it for me. The reality of this is, this is like, mental martial arts. If you're not going to put in the deliberate practice, you're never going to get to that elite level. You'll learn a lot of good things that are going to help you in life, and that's not a bad thing. But to really get to that level, you got to put in a number of hours with a good coach. One thing I actually learned from talking to a different sports psychologist this week was this whole idea of how these assessments make a difference. Because his point was, we can assess people ahead of time and see if they even have the propensity to do this. And then if they don't, we either figure out their weakness and how much longer we have to work at something like positive thinking. Some people are just better at it. They're more inclined to do it. So knowing that ahead of time can help you with your coaching regimen. But also, this type of training, once it's done right and done systematically, it actually can, be done fairly quickly. Lewis has created for a couple of, one corporation and one NFL team, he created what he called a mind room, which is a place where you could, without the coach, you can go in and do some of this training to build your skills. So that's another way to kind of get the stuff into more hands and to... The ultimate thing is, once you learn any of these skills, that's why we think it's important to get this into the younger officers sooner, because these are life skills that you have forever. And so that's another aspect of how we'd like to see this training go forward. So with that, Chris, we're ready for questions or ideas. We had some. I got to meet General Mingus yesterday and talk a little bit about this stuff, and got a lot of good ideas on how he wants to make these things work. Thank you.
We'll go ahead. Well, thanks for your comments. And what we'll do is we'll go ahead and open it up for questions. And Brian, if you'll take a chair there. What I will do, though, is since we couldn't get you guys to give you away the book, the first good question.
It's got to be good.
I have one is like, well, what color is this guy? Count, right? I might get that one right, maybe. I'll open it up to the first question from the audience or outside. All right, Nick, I will go with you. We'll come over.
Okay, thank you. I'm probably going to one French liaison officer here. And I think the aim of that is to be able to outthink an adversary on the battlefield. And I think what makes the difference between us and our adversaries, especially when it comes to expeditionary warfare, is that we get into an environment which is alien to us, but which is the environment our adversaries are used to. When we get to Iraq, Afghanistan, anywhere, we are facing people to whom it's they were born in this environment, that's their environment. And I sometimes, what I'm wondering is how can we better shape the way we are thinking, because the shock we have to manage is how we get prepared to there. And the difference between what we experience in our daily life in garrisons on force like this and what we experience once deployed has nothing to see. And sometimes I think that piling up the trainings, the training we have, is useful, of course, but I'm wondering how we could organize our daily life, garrison life, such a way that it prepares us outside the NTC rotations for specific courses to make better decisions, to be able to focus. I think there's a continuum we have to organize between our garrison life and the deployed life, which is above those specific trainings. So don't you think that there's also, in this repetition, the fact that our garrison life is too far away, it's sometimes too easy compared to what we experience in training sessions? What would you think about it?
Well, I can think of an example of somebody who he knew enough of this training, and he was deployed, and he had done some work to get these soldiers who hadn't been deployed to be ready for the experience of seeing dead bodies. And he knew he couldn't, you know, replicate that at an NTC, for example. But he actually did some imagery work with these guys, trying to teach them what he knew that they were going to feel, what it was going to be like. And he said he noticed that the guys that didn't take that training they were overwhelmed. They couldn't think. They were out of it. And so that's an example of using imagery to be prepared for that. I think there's something else that, you know, I don't know if you guys get trained on the OODA loop. You familiar with that? It's from a Korean War fighter pilot. But the whole concept is in decision making, if you can get inside the enemy's thinking, you can outmaneuver them. You're ahead of them. And I think there's something in this sports psychology training. It's called attentional style training. And it was a psychologist named Robert Niedefer. And he's the one that can, you know, his work shows that you can only put your attention in one place at one time, but there's four quadrants of attention. And there's one aspect of this where you kind of have to know that this point when you're making a decision, you have to check in with yourself. Are you ready to make this decision? Are you cool, calm, and collected? Are you thinking clearly? Are your emotions too high? And you know, all this work that Lewis did trains that skill. And the more you learn it, the faster you can go through that loop. An example of how that, just as an example of that training works is, you know, a quarterback on a football team, the first thing they have to do is look out broad external. They have to kind of see what the defense is. And then they have to take all that and using the training they had all week to how to handle that defense, internalize it, and then think of what's my decision going to be. But then he also has to check in to make sure that, again, you know, you see this all the time with defensive backs in football games. They get inside each other's head. And you can see these guys how they're not going to perform well because the other guys, he's in their OODA loop. And so that's one example of how you kind of have to learn to use this decision-making process almost automatically.
But to go further, just because maybe to clarify my question, is that the loop you're proposing and what you're saying is to work on oneself. How can I myself be prepared? In my garrison life, using that and using those techniques, how as a leader who's got to prepare a unit to be deployed, how can I change my style of command? How can I change my unit schedule such a way that I train my guys, I offer them opportunities to have this loop and making sure that I put them in situations where they have to focus, they have to make decisions, etc.
I think you got to give them these basic skills on how to focus and how to attend and how to build that capacity to do it under pressure. It's training.
I've done this on case, and I know this isn't talking this, but one technique may be, as you take an example of a book or a past battle or some situation that's out there, and bring your folks in, have it replicated with a sand table so they can actually see the ground and kind of visually walk through what actions they might take. And then you could use actually what happened through that whole process to provide that visual, if you will, as he's trying to get to it, if you're looking for a specific thing to do. It's something I think many people have used. We kind of forget about that when we get in garrison. When we get in garrison, we get so focused on the administrative and the other junk because that's what we get asked about as leaders. So at some point, a leader has to make the call and says, that's it. I'm going to take the responsibility, and I'm going to calm things down for everybody below me, almost like reducing the chaos for them and maintaining it at your level so they can actually focus and be individually attuned to what's going on, if that's helpful. All right. Any other thoughts on that same topic? Does he get a book for that one?
Sure.
And then since we had a follow-on, please, go ahead.
Yes, Casey Ajogo, Center for Army Leadership. I would like to get your thoughts on these mental skills that you talked about training. I assume they can be improved upon, they can be developed. My question is, are there, in your view, some inborn attributes or characteristics that one either has or doesn't that will lend themselves to succeed in these skills? For instance, if you have a group of trainees or leaders with sufficient physical characteristics, they're otherwise physically fit, so that's not a problem. They can cognitively function, that's not a problem. For these mental skills, are there, in your view, those of them that are inborn, that you have to have them to be able to succeed in this, or if you don't have them, these won't make any difference?
No, all these skills can be learned. They're all skills that anybody can develop. I mean, obviously, if there's certain, you know, if you're a sociopath or something, you're not going to be a positive thinker. But there are certain people who can learn these skills better and quicker. But anybody can improve these skills because they're physiological. If you're a real negative thinking guy and you're always, everything's the worst it could be, you can learn to change how you think.
So for example, a specific example, in one of the pages here, he talks about those who can thrive under pressure as one of the skills of stress management.
Right.
And he goes for that to say that these are not individuals who just are effective under pressure, but they welcome the pressure.
Right.
And these are the peak performers. And that leads me to think, is it then suggesting that for those who might not be comfortable under pressure, but they've been able to train themselves to deal with pressure, perform under pressure, not that they enjoy it, but they can surmount the occasion, rise to the occasion, deal with it effectively. After that, they will be like exhausted. So the difference here is this individual does not welcome the pressure, but once he or she is put in the situation, he can call upon his resources to perform and right. accomplish what is expected. So what are your thoughts on that? Does one need to be somebody who welcomes the pressure to be able to succeed in it?
No, because most situations where you're under pressure, of course you don't welcome them. That's why it's pressure. But when you understand that it's the stress is how you react to it, and you've been trained to understand that the stress is going to happen, it's how you react to it and how you recover from it.
So you don't have to like it.
You don't have to like it. Okay. You probably shouldn't like it. There's actually an issue with some special forces guys where they're essentially addicted to the peak performance. So that's a different fact. That's a different case. That's where they're actually too amped up for doing what they do, and you got to work with them in the off season, you know, to get back to reality. But that's, you know, small case, but it's an interesting phenomenon.
And it kind of leads into something we had a discussion about yesterday about, you know, how your performance comes out and goes down over time, but yet the equivalent of the body of work actually is an improvement or an increase or a handling of it. A follow-on to that question. So you've known me for quite a while now, and so you know I'm pretty negative on behaviors and thinking, and you've been working with me on my positive thinking. So what are some of the techniques you can help everybody to understand about how they can change their thinking from negative to more positive? Well, just something specific that maybe anybody around here could work on as a try.
Well, a good example is when you get in a road rage situation, right? Somebody cuts you off. Your first reaction is you're pissed, right? And you're going to go after that guy. Well, the outcome of that's never going to be good. So that's an example of a situation where you have to train yourself ahead of time. You can't do this in the moment. You have to know ahead of time when you're going to be in that scenario, I'm just going to turn it off. I'm not going there. And then what you have to do is replace the thought. So you have to say, oh, the guy's probably, his wife yelled at him today, or maybe he's going to the emergency room. And whatever you say to yourself doesn't have to be real. In your brain, it's real. So it gets you from that negative emotion to something that's neutral or positive. But literally, it's changed your behavior and your reaction from doing something stupid. So that's just a tip. You know, everybody can relate to that example.
Well, it's a good one. I actually wish I had heard that one this morning, because I had an incident this morning in the parking lot with some warrant officer that might be in this room, maybe, possibly. Where he cut me off to get into a parking spot. So I'm just saying, nothing specific there.
But that's the point of that is, you know, when you can anticipate scenarios in your world,
right?
You kind of know where these things are going to come up. That's why you train ahead of time so that when they come up, you're prepared. Yeah. Right. The other is you just start to understand, you know, the more you do it, the more you get good at it. You just learn that the consequence of keeping negative thoughts is just, what's the value of that? You know, you feel bad. You're not going to have a good day. And you just make it who you are. And the other thing is it transfers to everybody else around you, especially your family.
But, you know, everything I've heard you say so far, you know, responding to Nikolai and some other things that we've talked about is, it seems like the leader must spend a lot of time up front thinking about things and spending, so they understand things before they happen rather than reacting. Do you agree with that?
Yeah.
How would somebody try to put time and space in their calendar to think through those things? What are some techniques there?
I think the imagery techniques, because you don't need anything but your brain. You just imagine these scenarios over and over.
Okay.
And, you know, you can do the APEX type of training where you work with a coach and you go through a very formal process of getting from where you are now to where you want to be. That can take, you know, a couple of months of back and forth.
All right.
Because the other part about any of these skills, you got to apply them. You can't just go think about them and do them. You got to actually go and take one of the skills and come back a week later and say, you know, let's talk about situations you were in this week and what'd you do? And you'll, you know, get further coaching on what to do.
And that's something you could actually do with your own team as well.
Sure.
Yeah. Sir, you have a question there?
Yes. create a good leader and good performance take time. You need to make one decision after other. Even you have to learn about your own mistakes. How can you handle those mistakes in organization that of which they are not prepared to that mistakes? Because for one hand, we said you have to be creative. You have to apply innovation. But we do not accept mistakes. We have regulation, we have punishment, we even have a jail. So how can you handle in this process the mistake that you can make as a commander?
Well, they could be big mistakes, career limiting mistakes, or they could be this the little mistakes that happen every day, like yesterday.
Thanks.
Well, I mean, that was getting back to the leadership bullshit thing. It's these things come up every day where it might not be you making the mistake, but you got to take the blame because you're the leader. But then you're still feeling the pain. You're physiologically feeling bad because your boss is mad at you. So some of that is understanding, you know, how to let it go because it's a little mistake. You're not going to go to jail. The other part with the big mistakes, I think it's just sort of having conviction and courage and confidence that you're doing the right thing and it's not an ethical or moral bad decision. But that's sort of, because when you really get into this work, you get into things like character and who your inner self is and how you're, ultimately that's what drives all your decisions. I mean, that's the level of this training gets into that we couldn't talk about today. But, you know, in the corporate world, we have all these companies that are trying to innovate to stay in business. And it's kind of the biggest BS term is they always say, oh, we celebrate mistakes. That's not true. Anyway, one little mistake, you'll get away with. You make a big mistake, you're not around next year. And so it's an interesting problem, right? They try to say culturally we're about innovation and everything else, but the reality is it's not always the case. I was thinking about with my groups. So these are corporate execs. It's an interesting phenomenon in the corporate world where generally it's a couple both working. They're making 500 grand a year. Seems like a lot of money. They're barely making it on 500 grand a year. Kids going to school, blah, 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 their lifestyle. And now they're in these corporate jobs where they're getting fairly senior and they are in this position where they have to be very careful. Because I'd say about a third of my members over the years have been fired, right? They just, because a lot of my members are the more innovative types, so they take risks. But then what happens when you take risks, right? So they're constantly under this stress of, you know, they're doing well, but they kind of know that they're always on the line. And you can see it, and so part of they have to learn these kind of coping skills. Because the other part about, you know, the physiological stuff we're all dealing with, we go through low-level stress all day. And it's constant. And it's affecting your thinking. And you work with somebody like Megan, you can get these skills where you understand what's going on and you can regulate that. And, it, you know, it just improves your ability to think.
Get it. Get you. All right, hold on. We got one right back here behind you. He's got a short time.
Just had a question about how much perhaps the idea of emotional intelligence kind of played into this research. You know, I was reflecting on the example we talked about earlier about getting cut off in traffic, and you know, just how emotional intelligence kind of underpins the ability to manage those situations where we have self-awareness, self-management, and then that kind of awareness of others and relationship management. It just seems that kind of dovetails to support the ideas of adaptive thinking and stress management and being able to control our attention. And I just think that, is that a part of, or was that built into, or was that a part of the foundation for APEX?
Yes, it was. I mean, Lewis purposely went and got trained on the emotional intelligence work because it's all fundamental to this. I think what Lewis did was added the brain training to actually help you at that level of neuroplasticity. So it got beyond just thinking about the physiological brain-heart connection, but all right, what do we do about training the brain now? So yeah, he definitely was all over that and a lot of other, almost every other major leader development or psychology book that's been around for the last 15 years, he's incorporated into the model. I mean, he takes everything that's good and puts it in.
Makes sense. Okay.
One second. Did you have a follow-up to that, or I need? Okay, go ahead.
Sir, beyond stress management, what skills or what methods have y'all found or a way for a leader to thrive in a truly chaotic environment? A lot of these things, imagery, goal setting, and attention control, it requires you to have an understanding of what you're going into. And we keep talking about a more chaotic future, more high stress, we'll be less informed on what we're going to be going into. How have you been able, or have you started looking at how to get people to have situational understanding and awareness quicker so that they can then begin to apply some of these skills?
Well, that's exactly what this training is about, is having those inner skills so that in the situation you can make the decisions quicker. You can react quicker. You know what's going on physiologically, so you can deal with that right away. Or not even have to deal with it because it's become automatic. You've entrained yourself so well that you're not even going to go there. So that and this ability to understand where to pay attention in those chaotic situations, that also becomes more automatic the more you use it. So like I was using that example of a quarterback, the good quarterbacks just go through that decision-making loop faster and more almost intuitively. And that's the other part, is this understanding of intuition and when and when not to rely on it. It's all those four skills together that make it have the ability to be able to manage the stressful situation, right?
In fact, just training judgment into a person.
I haven't thought much about the connection to judgment, but there actually was a good book by Warren Bennis, all on judgment. And I remember at the time talking to Lewis about integrating that work into this work, because it's about decision making. So judgment's about, right? And I said the other part about this is it's this idea of the more you do it, the better you get. And the more they're all core skills. So you'll find that you'll start to practice things in all aspects of your life too. You'll make better judgments dealing with your wife and kid, when you normally might freak out on something. An interesting technique that Lewis teaches, he'll say, you go home after work and give your spouse 60 minutes of undivided attention. Literally don't say anything else except, how was your day? But 60 seconds, not 60 minutes. Just 60 seconds feels like a long time, because that's not what we do. We go home and we tell how bad our day is. And he said that one technique, one, it trains you to give full attention, but it also, you learn so much. And you learn that, hey, I'm going to learn things that I never would have heard. And that's just like, he has hundreds of these techniques. The other part is he teaches this notion of attention is, most of the time we're always worried about how people are attending to us. We're so focused on what they're thinking about us that we don't attend to them. And it's a basic communication skill. We're just not good at, because we don't think about it. But once we start to learn that, there's this two-way street on attention and heart, I could be talking to Chris and then I realize he's not even listening to me, right? So I got to check in and, fine. That's a bad example.
So. Did you have a follow-up back there? No, you'd asked a question before. You good to go? All right, you good? All right, you have one from the outside?
Yep. So, got one from the Facebook Live and 132 viewers right now. And the question is, as an army with 1 million soldiers from all walks of life with diverse backgrounds and experiences, where do you see this APEX training applied? Can it apply to all or just certain units and leaders?
Like I said earlier, the training can apply to anybody, any individual. We do a lot of work with school-age kids. We do a lot of work with wounded veterans. The skills can be applied to anyone, but I think in the case of the Army, what I think is it should only be applied starting with more its peak performance. So let's start with people who need peak performance. And one thing to think about is you have a school like this where you're bringing through people to learn to be leaders. Those people are going to, if they learn some of these skills and they apply them, they're going to transfer those skills. So I would focus on the schoolhouses, ROTC, maybe Ranger Regiment, Special Forces, and focus there first because they're all more inclined to put in the peak performance work. The other people who just can gravitate to it and make the commitment, that's fine, but I wouldn't try to roll out an Army-wide program because you're going to waste a lot of money and time. That's kind of what, comprehensive soldier fitness gives these skills to that level, and that's fine. But they're never going to be doing like peak performance for people under combat pressure or senior leaders making critical decisions. That's not what they're geared up for. So it's kind of interesting to look at what they can offer for the soldier and family member versus, this idea of leader development, peak performance.
Another question? Yeah, please, Megan.
Less content related, but more in terms of the method of training, speaking of CSF2 as well. What have you found the best method for increased efficacy in terms of continued change and implementation of the individuals or the groups? So like group training versus individual, do you teach the science? Do you just do applied work? Is it a continuous connection with the client or is it just a one-time go? What have you found has been the best model for that?
Well, first of all, I'd have to charge you if I told you the answer. But it depends. I mean, it depends what the performance scenario is. And right? Because obviously the best way to do it is individual coaching, because these are all individual skills. But do you have the luxury of doing that, the time, the money? And then there are some times when you could, well, like the basic education on how all this stuff works, like everything in that book, that's basically a 3 or 4 day course. You could probably make it longer. There's a lot of stuff to teach, but that's giving you the education that how this all works. Then to work with a person on their performance, then you gotta get into coaching, right? And there are ways to, there's more and more apps out there to help people with, I think the Army actually, didn't they design a goal setting app? But there's plenty of other apps to help you with the physiological side that people can work with. I don't think they're ever doing enough with the affirmation CDs. They're not CDs anymore, they're MP3s. Back in the day, they were CDs. But those affirmation, that work, I think, can be commoditized. There can be tools where people can, a lot of those affirmations are pretty standard. So you can go in and basically have a software that can help you write them up for you and then go in and update them. That could be made simpler with technology. I think the other big thing is going to be virtual reality, augmented reality tools. Some of the stuff that you've seen, Chris, that are going to help, that you're going to have essentially virtual coaches. And there's an aspect of this work where a coach that's anonymous is actually better to work with. So whether it's a coach that's via the web, you don't really know who they are, and they're a real coach, or if it's an AI version of a coach, the AI can get so good that that's a way to scale the training. But I think ultimately the real peak performance stuff has to be one-on-one with a good coach trained like you.
Mm-hmm. We have another question back. Can you come up to a mic though, would you mind? Just so the outside world can hear you.
This is actually a follow-on to this discussion that we just had, and that is, you know, this appears to be very individual-oriented. But we know, and based upon some of the other discussions, we know that that individual has to make meaning of the experience, and that meaning-making comes from quality coaching. So what's the component of the program that produces those coaches that can make meaning for those that we're developing for peak performance?
Are you talking about training the trainers?
Yes, yeah. I mean, for example, when you get to the when you get to the comprehensive soldier fitness, the Army has the master resilience trainers and those mm-hmm. kinds of things, and that's an attempt. But realistically, we're looking at the individualized coaching. Typically, that's going to come from the leaders within the organization. How do you maximize the coaching capacities for those leaders?
You mean the leaders who have full-time jobs doing something else?
That's exactly what I mean, yeah. And because it's not natural. The leader himself or herself may have internalized this, and it may work very well for them. But to convey that to someone else that we're trying to develop to peak performance takes special talent, special skills. And so what's the coaching component? How do we develop those coaches?
It's interesting because we work with an NFL team, and we decided not to work with the players. We worked with just the coaches. And the coaches and the other management in the team. And the reason was, typically a coach, there are a lot of yellers and screamers, and they tell you what not to do, and none of those techniques work. And you have to get them to understand positive thinking, and when I'm going to tell you not to fumble. I can't tell you not to fumble because what happens in your brain is you see fumbling and you fumble. I have to tell you your hands are a vice. I have to have this whole shift in how I say things. And that's just one example, but you have to do it with everything you say where it has to be understood that how's the trainee's brain going to pick it up. So there's some coaching that can be done at that level, just teaching people how they talk about things, how they teach. But that's the only part I can see where you can teach that to that level. I think if you can learn this physiological thing, if you can learn the stress response work, that's something you can probably transfer and teach to others once you've mastered it. But I think that the main thing is getting to that level of teacher. And so once they learn it and they internalize it and it becomes who they are and how they speak to people, some of it will just rub off because you're doing it. But then I think you do have to be more conscious of how you teach others to do it too.
So as an example too, is I've seen some battalion commanders use with the Center for Enhanced Performance. They would have them come in and teach and talk to the leaders specifically and work with them first, and then come back at a follow-on date and talk with the whole unit as a big group. But then the leaders have already been kind of transformed into that thinking process and some of these techniques. So then they could just reinforce it. So they're not the actual, sometimes it's really hard to get into the nuances of everything, you know, as you're kind of talking, and you lose that the more distance you get from the actual person that's trained in doing that. So that's the way I've seen them do that in the past. It seemed to be pretty successful. You have to start with the folks that are over top, like you talked about with the coaches.
So that's what I've seen. We incorporated this teaching in with a Gettysburg staff ride because, you know, our thing is there's not more of a VUCA environment than a battlefield like that. There's plenty of examples of volatility, uncertainty, and complexity. And so we used the staff ride to teach. At each point on the staff ride, we taught one of these principles. But what we did was we took 20 of their senior executives, heads of a company, heads of a division, we took them there first and went through, this is how we're going to teach it, and this is why we're going to teach it, and actually we want you to teach it with us. So then they did their homework, they learned the concepts, they didn't learn these skills because that's a different level of teaching, but they learned the concepts so that then it was easy for them when we did the staff ride with 120 of their execs. They had already internalized the learning and they could articulate it and tell stories and take it back to the job, because now they're going back with their company and they all now have learned these same skills. So that was an interesting way to teach the teachers. And we use the staff ride as the mode to do it. So you can maybe create a staff ride type training.
Okay. Do we have another short question? We have time for one short question, or we can wrap it up right there. That was a good one to wrap up on.
I had one more thought. With looking at the research that's been done since 1986 now, it almost would be interesting to see if the Army was ready for a chief cognitive officer. Somebody who's actually going to look around the Army at all these things that are cognitive development and get a grasp of it. And then I would then form a sort of community of practice of the people that are doing the best work, but I'd make them test in. Like, I wouldn't just make it, hey, everybody that cares about this is now on the team. I would say, you really have to show that you understand cognitive science, and now we're going to form a team. And then go back and look at the practical applications of how do we train to it, and where do we maybe cut out some things that just aren't getting there. But just an idea that I had today.
All right.
Maybe there's a job for you in there.
So
you might not test in, though.
Yeah, I got to test in. That may be a problem for me. You know, and to give you guys an example of this, and I'm so invested in this program, and I really like some of the things I've heard of it. Just as an example, at Fort Campbell High School, their football team for 3 years running had been the number one team in the state. They had 7 kids that went off to a Division I scholarship, one to Notre Dame and one to play linebacker Kentucky, and 2 kids now are one's in the NFL and one's in the CFL. Could not get over the hump to winning the state championship game. Brought in the team, they came, had a discussion with the group, talked to them about goal setting, worked with the coaches, went through the whole process. They had lost all 7 of those kids. The year before, there was an in-between year, they had lost 7 games. I mean, it was unheard of at Fort Campbell High School. After this training experience and really investing in this program, they ended up going on to win 3 state championships consecutively with arguably a little less talent than they had had the years before that. So I've seen a physical, something physically happen. I was there with that, the whole process and helping out with the team. So I've seen this work. I've seen it work with military units. And I think there's some real value into what we're doing. And Brian, we really appreciate the time you've taken today. Do you have, I'll just get it from you. So we have a quick gift for you, signed by the commander. And thank you for taking the time to come out today and talk to us about this.
Thank you.
Did you have any other, you're good on it? You have any questions?